There was a somber ceremony yesterday just offshore from Port of Basque. It marked a grim anniversary in Newfoundland's history. Here Now's Doug Greer was there yesterday and has this report.
It was 70 years ago today that a German submarine torpedoed and sank the passenger ferry Caribou as it steamed from North Sydney to Port of Basque. 136 people died.
The ferry Atlantic Vision plies the same waters on the same course as the Caribou. And it was the Vision that hosted the ceremony remembering the dead and the survivors from that day.
Ladies and gentlemen, today we are commemorating the 70th anniversary of the sinking of SS Caribou.
As it is on land, so it is on the water. The symbols of commemoration are the same. Picture those same harsh waves at this very spot, in the dark, the ship gone.
Of the 237 passengers and crew of the Caribou, only 101 could be recovered. 136 men, women, and children were lost in the most devastating attack in Canadian waters in the Second World War.
And there were other, more personal commemorations. Inside those boxes, the ashes of veterans with strong ties to the Caribou, committed now to the deep.
Because it's where his father died on the SS Caribou when he was 18 years old, and that's what he wanted.
Charlie Andrews' father, Eric, survived the attack.
As he approached the hatch to leave the ship, the boilers exploded. He was catapulted into the sea and away from the ship.
There's a lot of stories untold about this war, and if they don't do something like this here, it's all going to be forgotten.
People here are determined the Caribou, the lost, and the rescued will not be forgotten.
As my father's ashes were going over the side, I was thinking to myself that his wishes were finally completed, that he wanted to be buried at sea in a naval tradition.
It really brings my father's life full circle, and I'm very glad it could happen for him.
Doug Greer, CBC News, aboard the Atlantic Vision.
This weekend, a somber ceremony took place on the Cabot Strait, in the exact spot where the ferry Caribou was sunk by a German torpedo. That was 70 years ago in 1942. 130 passengers and crew drowned. Tonight, we get the story of what it was like that night from a man who was there. Percy Moores was in the British Navy and was returning home on leave to Newfoundland. He told his story to Here and Now's David Zeltzer.
4 o'clock in the morning, we all got rudely awakened. The torpedo hit us midships. There was only 4 minutes till the ship was gone.
Seventy years ago in 1942, a Gulf ferry, the Caribou, sank off Port of Basque. It had been hit by a German torpedo. It was the deadliest disaster in Canadian waters during the Second World War. More than 100 people survived, and we caught up with one of them here in Cottrell's Cove.
Percy and Bea Moores have been married for 65 years.
It was my boyfriend when I was 15.
They were childhood sweethearts. This is a story about survival, but it's also a love story.
I thought about it as being, oh, miles across there.
The hills got smaller when we left.
They raised their 3 children in Florida, but they come home every summer. This is Bee's place, Cottrell's Cove. Percy's from around the corner, Moore's Cove. In 1942, Percy was a sailor in the British Navy on a minesweeper in the English Channel. Bea was only 16 and still home. She'd spend most of the war in Tennessee and Boston going to nursing school. And you couldn't just pick the phone up and say you were headed home on leave in 1942.
To get the news, if they wanted to, they could come in the post office and read what was outstanding that particular day or the day before.
So when Percy got on the Caribou, Bea thought he was either in England or New England.
I hadn't heard from him for a long time and had no idea where he was.
We were all pretty well fortified with a little bit of, you know, and stayed up late talking, fooling on, and nobody even thought I guess the war was far out of our minds at that time. We were on leave. We were going home.
It was a night crossing. The Caribou had an escort, the Canadian minesweeper Grand Mare. German U-boats had already sunk 19 ships off the East Coast. They'd only take one more.
And then at 4 o'clock in the morning, we all got rudely awakened.
Reizen Abschuss! Feuer!
When did you first realize there was something wrong that night?
The torpedo hit us pretty well midships, and I was in a bunk at the time, at the top bunk, and knocked me out clear out of the bunk onto the floor. So I scrambled up the stairwell there. But there's only 4 minutes, see, from the time the torpedo hit till the ship was gone. And it didn't give you much time to think, even.
Many people died in the frigid Atlantic because of a problem with the lifeboats.
Art and I tried to help get the lifeboats off, you know. But they weren't prepared for it. I guess they weren't expecting it because everything was rusty and no time to do anything about it, you know. We had a habit in the Navy of using our life jackets for a pillow. Most of the time you put your life jacket on, especially if you were in a certain circumstances, you put your life jacket on and use it for your pillow, and that's what I was doing that night. But the second I came on deck, somebody ripped that life jacket off me. Just grabbed a hold of it and tore it off. So I almost darn near drowned there. I hope the guy that tore it off survived, because I survived without it.
They were 35 kilometers off Port of Basque.
I headed for the bridge and almost drowned myself because the suction of the ship took me under for a while. When I came to surface, I heard people on the, you know, I heard them singing and crying and whatever have you, and I swam for the raft, got on a raft.
The sea was calm when the torpedo hit, but it was now angry with a southwest wind. The survivors spent 4 hours hanging on while people all around them slipped away. Percy Moores was in a life raft that was overloaded with survivors.
It was so full, though, so crowded, that it rolled a couple times and lost some of the people, you know. But it stayed till we were picked up. It couldn't maintain it, all the people that were trying to get on it first. You know, there wasn't room for it. There was nowhere to. There were still a lot of people that just held on to the side of it, you know. But you couldn't do that for very long in that kind of water. You couldn't stay in it very long without giving up.
Back in Cottrell's Cove, B had no idea what was going on.
Nobody knew. His mother hadn't heard from him in a bit longer than usual or something. But she was his mother. When she heard about the caribou, one of the first things she said is, "I suppose Percy is not on that."
A lot of singing. After things quieted down a little bit, people were singing hymns and songs, a squid jigging ground or whatever you could think about, you know. Yeah, I didn't think there was much hope. They're 20 miles out there in the ocean and no life jacket. It's a sort of a tricky situation. I seem to remember saying goodbye to everybody that I knew, but I seem to remember something about that. But gosh, you know, I didn't think there was much chance, I guess. Of course, when you're 19 years old, you always think there's a chance, or at least you go for one.
The escort ship Grand Mare had been ordered to pursue the German sub, but it eventually returned for the survivors.
All I had on was my top, my tunic and stuff like that. I was just had underpants and the rest was naked, and one of the sailors gave me a pair of pants.
It was big news in Newfoundland. Even in 1942, word made it back quickly to tiny, isolated Cottrell's Cove.
His mother got a telegram from, I don't know where it was from, the War Department, or that he would be home the next day, and she figured it out from there. If they were telling her that, it probably was because he was on the caribou.
A couple of days later, Percy walked back into Cottrell's Cove.
I was in the barn, cleaning up and doing something with the horses, well, one horse at least, and I had a pair of rubber boots on that came up to here somewhere, and I was a mess. And I came out to come home and ran right into him. I was, like I say, I was a mess. And when I saw him coming, I ran. So he wouldn't see me like that. He came back to the house. He had to come down here to see me. We saw each other as much as we could when he was here. It's almost like the previous years hadn't happened, you know.
It was war. And it was a little closer to home than any of us expected, I guess.
The British Navy docked his pay until it had recovered the money it cost to replace the uniform and the kit that he lost on the Caribou. But Moore says he more than made up for it over the years with free trips on the Gulf Ferry. David Zelser, CBC News, Cottrell's Cove.